Shalom to all our students and friends, and this time we are in Parashat VaYikra, the book of Leviticus. The name of the book, the whole book, is also VaYikra, which means, and he called. Who called? What called? Why, how do you start a book with and, A-N-D? VaYikra el Moshe. That's the beginning of the book. What is this parasha about? This parasha is mostly about the offerings that have been served by the Kohanim in the tabernacle. Okay, so what's in it for us? We do not, at least today, we're not offering any physical offerings, not cows and not lambs and stuff like this. So what's in it for us? And the story is much more sophisticated. So if you follow the teachings of the Kabbalistic teachings of the weekly portion, you know that when we celebrate Rosh Hashanah, Til Simchat Torah, it's a cosmic opportunity, it's an opening for each one of us to restart his life and make a real difference in cleansing, upgrading ourselves, and so on. By the end of the holiday season, Simchat Torah, in the month of Tishrei, Libra, we're starting to read the book of Bereshit, Genesis. Okay, why Genesis? Why do we have to start to read it all over again? Because we learn that through the readings of the book of Genesis, we are calling in the programming, the consciousness of Abraham, the patriarch, which is the power of and consciousness of Chesed, loving kindness. That without it, you can't really do anything properly in this world. And then you have to do also the judgment. Din, Gvura, Isaac, the patriarch Isaac. And after that, that's not enough, because you have to learn how to synthesize the two, and that is Jacob, the patriarch. Okay? Joseph gives us the ability of Sfirat Yesod to manifest it, bring it down to reality. And the 12 sons of Jacob, that's about the 12 signs of the zodiac, that each one of us is composed of all of them together in a different mixture. That's what makes us differently. And we have different tikkun. And the moment we have those programs downloaded or upgraded every year and new, we can really go for our war of independence. And this is the book of Shemot, Exodus. Getting out of Egypt, getting out of the narrow box of narrow thinking, narrow-mindedness, and so on, and excelling until we build the tabernacle, which means we're building our own temple, our own mishkan, our own dwelling place for the light to come in. And that ends by the end of the book of Exodus last week. Now, VaYikra starts a new period. Most of the book is about the offerings and about purification. Except one important thing, in the middle of the book, Parashat Kedoshim, we have maybe the most famous mitzvah, love others as you love yourself. Okay, so what do we get out of this parasha? So as it starts, VaYikra el Moshe, and he called Moses. What is that? It looks like it's out of the blue. And the Zohar goes into signs and omens, and using the Hebrew letters as signs and omens. And I know a lot of people that have this obsessive compulsive tendency to look always for omens. You see, that's an omen. You see, that's another sign. It's a sign from God for this and this and that. And we have to be really careful about it. Why? Because when we're coming to speak about the offerings, the Zohar has a very unique way to access that whole teachings of offerings. And what is it about? You'll find that in the Zohar Sulam, verse 51. And he says over there, Rabbi Chiya ya matzui lifnei Rabbi Shimon. Rabbi Chiya was there studying with Rabbi Shimon. Amar lo ze shenikra korban. And he said to him, the fact that the offering is called korban, and you know, in Hebrew, the word korban has many meanings, many shorashim, which is the letters kuf reish bet. There are some, you know, one meaning is krav, a battle. Another meaning is karov. And that's what Rabbi Shimon is using right now. Karov should be karov. Karov means closeness. What is the whole thing about the offerings, the korbanot? It's about getting closer to the upper sefirot, to the tree of life. This is the whole thing. Now, there's another meaning to the word korban. It means also a victim. And you know, a lot of people, when they take a spiritual journey, they think they have to sacrifice a lot in order to connect to God. The problem is that when you sacrifice, there is a kind of feeling that, you see, I made myself suffer just for you, God. Like the Creator himself needs anything from us just to remind us whatever we have, it's from him. And because he's endless, the fact that I have something doesn't take anything away from his. So you take half of the endless, there's still endless left. So, but, and we take, you know, whatever. So whatever we offer to him, it's his anyway. So why do we feel that we did him a favor when we give charity, or we give away time, and or we don't eat, or we sacrifice something that we think is ours by giving it to somebody else, and we say, take it as a sacrifice? That's being in a victim mode. And victims are not winners. They're usually losers. And the Creator is a winner consciousness, not a victim consciousness. So here it is, Rabbi Shimon is teaching us, when you bring an offering, it's not a sacrifice. It's a closeness. Because when you, as we learn about Teruma, you raise yourself when you share with others. Don't see it as a sacrifice, because this is a negative way to look at it, and it's not going to get you anywhere. So what? Let's go back about the omens. We need omens. We need. But omens are not so useful, practical, in our spiritual journey, because Balaam also had the ability to create omens and miracles and magic. And also Pharaoh's wizards, they could do that too. So the fact that somebody has an omen, does that mean that it's a great good sign from heaven? No, the Kabbalists are saying, Rabbi Chaim Vital in Sharei Kedusha says, usually when you start your spiritual journey, remember, you're just in the beginning. So you have, it's not a beginner's luck. It's basically, those signs are coming from the dirt you're still involved with and you did not cleanse yet. Why? It can give you some ego about and pride about, look at me. This is a test that usually we're being tested. Are we going to be taken by the pride of seeing those supernatural omens? Or are we going to say, I don't know how can I take it, but I need to go back to my spiritual journey and getting closer to the light. Therefore, we really must see the whole thing about omens as like, you know, this is a game. Never take it seriously. It could be even a joke. Because the real omen is very simple. In this parasha also, we have an extension of previous parashot where it speaks about the offerings, starting from chapter 4, verse 1, the offerings sinners should brain. What does that mean? And as we said before, the fact that somebody sinned consciously, it was not by real meaning. The fact that that exists does not mean that you cannot fix it. The purpose of the offerings is to get closer to the light. And as long as you live, you can still make the offerings, which means getting closer to the light. And that could be giving the time and praying, but you're not sacrificing. You're simply elevating yourself. You're not, when you give charity, it's about elevating yourself. So there's always a way to fix and to correct. Never, ever forget it. But how do I know? How do I get the signs that I'm doing my job properly? And here comes Rabbi Akiva, that we know that during the time of the Omer, these are the 7 weeks starting from the day after Passover, till Shavuot, the holiday of Shavuot, that we know that 24 students of Rabbi Akiva died in a plague during those weeks because they did not respect each other. Which means they didn't really think that their master was really serious when he said, love others as you love yourself is the highest rule of the whole Torah. It's a general rule that includes all of them. And how? It's the simplest and the most embarrassing omen. Why? Because it's so clear. How do I know magically that I'm on the right path? And the answer is very simple. When I bring my offerings and I make the effort to get closer to the light of God, and I do it because I just want to connect to His light and nothing else, and I don't feel any sorrow and I don't feel victim, but I just do all that effort either with prayers or with actions and meditations just to get closer. The biggest omen that you cannot be mistaken about is the omen that you are more loving, more kind, more caring, more tolerant towards other people than you've been before. This is the biggest magic of them all, the most powerful, and it's the most clear. Because when I have the energy, the power, the ability, the words to be kinder, loving, and caring, and more tolerant, and merciful, and more compassionate, there is no bigger omen than that, and it's the true, real omen. That's the biggest real magic. What is magic? That you have a, like, abracadabra, and it's a magic, and wow, that's artificial. That's for just the pride. The real magic is whatever you do, whatever effort you make, and then you realize that you're tired, but you're more loving. That yes, you gave up a lot of stuff that you thought it's important, but the reward, it's the warmth and the compassion, is so much better than what you had before that was only physical or whatever. That's one big omen. If you continue, says the Zohar, with using this omen more and more, you'll realize there's another one which is even bigger. And that is that as you're closer to the upper worlds and you're closer to the light, there's less chaos in your life. And the Zohar speaks about, we're talking about one of the major powerful essays in the Zohar that's in the end of the entrance to the Zohar, introduction to the Zohar. And it says over there that the mitzvah of love is one of the greatest. But don't be mistaken, says the Zohar. You can say, I love God, I love God, I love God, and meanwhile you are being plagued by so many troubles. And I love God, and I don't care, like I love Him unconditionally, whatever. And the Zohar says, hello? Are you naive? Are you a fool or something? There are problems, things are chaotic. It means you're doing something wrong. Look around. Think carefully. be obsessed with changing yourself, changing the way you're doing things, because by that effort, finally you're going to realize that you are really doing something wrong, because the fact there's more and more chaos in your life shows that you're doing something wrong. And loving God is not, you know, maybe you're just fooling yourself. How do you know you're not fooling yourself? You can love others too. Just human beings, mortals, with their mistakes, and you have more compassion for their mistakes and their shortcomings. At the same time, there's less chaos in your life. Therefore, we're starting a period that by working out that energy and connecting to the grace, because the whole parasha of VaYikra, the whole book is a book of Leviticus, but it's basically about the Kohanim, which is Kohen, is the energy of Chesed, grace, loving kindness. This force is available during these days in magical forms and powers and amounts. And our job is just to allow it to come in by our actions. The peak is in the full moon of the month of Nisan, which is called the night of the Passover Seder. Do you know what Seder means in Hebrew? Order. When we can overcome our negativities, when we can overcome, you know, the fact that we are looking for selfish stuff, when we can really raise ourselves, offer ourselves our time and energy and body and might and desires, we can reach that place that we go above all the selfishness, and that's, you know, overcoming the chametz, the whole thing about the matzah, the whole thing about Passover is overcoming slavery, which is selfishness, and then we achieve seder, order in our lives. This is the outmost of it is being revealed in the night of Passover, and then it continues till Shavuot. The amount of light we reveal in the coming 9 weeks, that will determine how much order or chaos will be in our lives in the coming years. Thank you so much, and have a great success in the journey towards spirituality. Chodesh Tov.